very important word, and it is very useful to everybody. Okay, we can use that. Some of the management things, whatever we are talking about, we can implement it in our lives. That is a good thing about this management thing. What is synergy? Anybody? Okay. So synergy is it is such a beautiful word. Synergy means 1 plus 1. We know that it is 2. In terms of mathematics, it is 2, but cooperation of 2 or more organization. Very good, Sangeet. Okay. So how synergy can make 1 plus 1 more than 2, right? It can make it any. It can become 3, 4, any number. 1 plus 1 can become more. How 1 plus 1 can become more than 2 is when this right word, Sangeeta, is used, cooperation. When you work in as a team, let's say you are individually you are working on some task, right? So your productivity is at certain level, and let us say we bring in your best friend, okay, who is also knowledgeable about that task. Automatically, when you combinedly, when you start working together, the amount of work done increases drastically, isn't it? So synergy will increase the whole when we have individual energies, when we have the team, each member will complement each other. So it can be organization or it can be departments, one department complementing other department, so that as a together they will be very, very effective. That is called as synergy. So you must use this word synergy as a when you are working in a IT industry or anywhere, or any personal life, any kind of a work, you should think about this word synergy. When right kind of a people get together, they form the team, the productivity increases. Okay, the work, the amount of work that can be done drastically increases. So as a team member, when you are working, you should complement with the other team member. That is how you can bring out the synergy of the team. And when you are a manager, when you become a manager, you should make sure that your team is complementing each other and the whole team is coming up quickly. Like how normally the team helps is like, there will be like when you pass out, you join as a fresher, and there will be senior people in the project team, and there will be freshers. So senior people will groom these people, so they will try to bring them best out of it. So that is how the whole team will perform better. So that is the word synergy. And one more thing about like when we are working, that is one thing is a synergy. Second thing is setting up a formal environment. What is a formal environment is like formal environment is like when you come to the college, you have the all the setup, desks are there, you come neatly dressed, okay, then the classes will go on. When we are working in a formal environment, automatically the focus, the productivity will increase. Okay, you must have noticed like all of the classes now are going online. And most of the time, like you are in an informal environment. So try to convert that informal environment into formal environment if it is possible. What I mean by that is, like, suppose in your house, whenever you are attending any kind of online classes or any online coaching or any webinar, or you are doing some project work, mini project work, you are learning something, set aside an area. Okay, your system, your laptop, your chair, your table, and approach this thing like every day you have class from 10 to 12:45. Take it as a formal, you can convert your informal environment to formal environment. You can get up, you get ready by 10 o'clock, you sit in your environment with neatly dressed, so your focus will increase. So that is a whenever we are put in a formal environment, naturally the focus will increase, the productivity will increase. So try to, if possible, try to convert so that you can make the learning very effective for all of you. Okay, we'll continue with where we stopped. Okay, we were talking about the modern approaches. Okay, so modern approaches were like a quantitative approach we looked into. In case of a quantitative approach, like whenever we are making a decision as a manager, whenever management is making a decision, the quantitative, some of the decision making will help with when we see the figures or the numbers, when there are quantities are present. So quantitative approach used that as a basic idea, where they use the operation research. We talked about the OR, then statistical approaches they used to formally get a number using that figure or the probability. decision can be made. So that is that's the quantitative approach. Then system approach. System approach was like all along, like this is an evolution of the theories. We saw like sometimes there are overlaps, sometimes the concepts are totally new. We saw like from classical approach, like more focus was given on one part or the other part. Okay, the system was never thought of as a whole system. Okay, so system approach, one of the thing it proposed was central to the systems approach is the concept of holism. So as a whole, like a whole system, whenever we are analyzing any problem, we have to consider as a system as a whole instead of just looking at the what the problem area. Let us say in an organization, suppose one department has certain problem. So you should not be with the systems approach, you should not be looking at just that department. We have to see the relation between that department and the rest of the departments of the organization, and keeping in mind that whole organization in mind, we should try to solve the problem. And we saw one example, okay, about the restaurants. Here, like like whenever their workload was more, there was a lot of discontentment, and people were not happy, and they were leaving the jobs, and managers was not able to handle the situation, things like that. When this particular problem was approached from the systems approach. Okay, so people were leaving, they were not happy. So if it sounds more like a something related to the employees, maybe if we approach from the just the this, like people are leaving, they are not happy, maybe you will focus on the human part of the problem or the relation part of the problem. When you look, when researchers looked at the whole organization, what is happening, they studied, they found out like there is a the way the information passed is not correct. So the information passing was the problem for all these things. So they came up with the one idea. They installed a spindle where waitress will not talk to the cook directly or need not wait for the cook. They will put their request on the spindle, which will be like a queue. So then things started moving properly and everybody started performing well. So this is one example that was done. That gave a great result with the approach used is the system approach. They look the whole problem as a not as an individual problem, just to that human related problem. They looked it into the complete organization. They studied, then they came up with the solution. Okay, so. See, this is the last thing what it says. Had researchers limited their analysis only to the people component, it means people component, people were having problem, this, that, they were leaving the job, this would have led them to exploring such inappropriate answers as incentive schemes, okay, some kind of incentive, human relations training, selection procedures, time and motion studies, etc. The third thing is, system can be either open or closed. Open system is what? Which interacts with the environment. An open system is the one which interacts with its environment. A closed system is one which is independent of the environment. So when we have the open system, it will interact with the external environment. The closed system is a like a closed. It will not interact with the external environment. The classicists regarded organization as a closed system. They ignored the effect of the environment. So the classical approaches, they thought the organizations are closed organization. They don't interact with the environment. But the truth is what? All the living system, whether biological organization or social or business organizations, are actually dependent upon their external environment for the information, material, and energy. Okay, even the biological organizations, so any social organization, any kind of organization, it depends on the environment. Environment, where it is present, it will directly interact. How it will dependent on the or how it will interact with the environment is like whatever the information, it could be material, it could be like energy. These are the different interactions one organization will have with the environment. These enter the system from the environment as input and leave the system as output. So all these environmental things, they come in as an input and it will leave the system as output. So here one example of this is like when you are driving a car or a bike, like it is a kind of a it's a like a feedback system is there. You are looking at the environment, okay, when you are driving, as the road turns, okay, that is the input that is given to your system. When you see that the road is turning, that is the input you give. How you get the output? The output will be in terms of turning the handle according to the turn. So that is how every system, it takes the environmental inputs and gives some kind of a system output. Hence, they are rightly conceived as an open system by modern writers. Okay, the inputs of a business organizations are, okay, the for the business organization, there are examples of the inputs. It can be raw materials. Okay, power, whatever the power requirement the organization has, finance is like funding, loans, whatever the organization has, equipments, then human efforts, technology, and information about the market, new products, government policies. Okay, government policies is a big environmental factor for any industry. Okay, based on the government policies, like there will be a lot of impact on the organization. So these are the examples of the environmental inputs. The organization changes these inputs and it produces the outputs of what kind of output? It will be like some kind of a goods or services and a satisfaction. If it is a service oriented organization, it will satisfaction would be the outcome. This transformation process is known as a throughput. So whatever the process of taking the input from the environment and changing that and converting it into a goods or service or any kind of output, this whole thing is called as a throughput. This transformation from input to output, this transformation is called as a throughput. Okay, and what are the different kinds of transformation processes? We talked about transformation. Input is converted into an output that is called as a transformation. And what kind of a transformation we can have? Generally, they are categorized as follows. One is the physical transformation. Physical transformation as in a manufacturing. Let us say raw iron, you convert it into some part of the automobile. So that is a physical transformation. Location transportation, you are moving goods from one place to another place. Exchange, okay, in retailing, in the retail industry, you are exchanging, okay, the goods, and you are giving the money to the in favor of the exchange. Then storage is like in warehousing, you store the goods or the products, whatever you have created. Physiological, okay, there are a lot of physiological transformation in case of a healthcare. Informational as telecommunication, so the data would be transformed from one form to another form in case of a information array. So information can be like any kind of a information input that will result in the some kind of a output, that is called as a informational transformation. These transformations are not mutually exclusive. So one thing about the transformation is the transformations are not mutually exclusive, means what one transformation is not dependent on another. So it is not like that. All the system, all the transformations will be interdependent. That is the meaning of mutually exclusive. For example, a retailer can allow customers to compare the prices and quality. So you can see here there is a interdependency or the comparison between the two transformations. Hold items in the inventory until needed. Okay, so it is a goods, that is the output, and the storage, that is the inventory that we have. Sell goods, that is exchange. It should be remembered that the output of a system is always more than the combined output of its parts. This is called as a synergy. So this is what we talked about, the a synergy. What it says is it should be remembered that the output of a system is always more than the combined output of its system, of its parts. Suppose there is one system, it has like n number of parts. The combined output is always more than the output of each of these parts. That is a synergy. In organizational terms, synergy means that a separate department within the organization cooperate and interact. They become more productive than if they had acted in isolation. So if they had acted in isolation, means if they have just worked on their own. Okay, if you are doing some work, you are doing it alone, it will take a little more time, or whatever the work, it may not be that interesting to you. When a right partner joins with you, this becomes more interesting. Then if there is any problem, you the other person can help with that problem. That is how the productivity will increase. So when we are making a team, the team should complement each other. That is when the productivity of the team is very high. And opposite to the synergy, if a team members start draining each other, the productivity will drastically go down. So achieving synergy is the most important thing in any kind of a team or any kind of a organization. For example, it is obviously more efficient for each department in small firm to deal with one financing department than for each department to have a separate financing department of its own. So one example is, instead of having like a financing department for each department, we can have one central financing, so that each department cooperate with that central financing department, and the productivity will be higher. One important mechanism which enables a system to adapt and adjust to changing condition of its environment and to exercise control over its operation is a feedback. So every whenever we talk about the open systems, there is a feedback mechanism. We get the input. Feedback is that nothing but the input. It can be any kind of a input. That is what we talked. It can be information, it can be material, it can be human resources. Anything can be the input. So it has a feedback system, and according to a feedback system, it exercises the different controls based on the feedback. So for same example, driving, based on the feedback, road is turning, you will turn the handle. So again, when the road is straight, you will not make any changes to the handle, because the kind of feedback you are getting, according to that you are controlling. So you will exercise the control with respect to what kind of feedback you are getting. As operations of the system proceed, information is fed back to the appropriate parts so that the work can be assessed and, if necessary, corrected. So feedback is taken, and based on the feedback, a necessary action will be taken if it is required. So this is the diagram of open system organization. You can see here we have the inputs here, okay, input of information, energy, material, and this is the transformation process which we call it as the throughput, and this is the environment. Okay, after the transformation the inputs are converted into outputs such as products, ideas, services, and again this is fed back as an input, as an information. So whatever products or whatever you are doing, you will take this kind for example, like when you are when Amazon or any e-commerce website, they sell any products, so there is an option to give the feedback, okay, and different ratings, and also you can put text information there. Those feedbacks are studied, okay, those feedbacks are studied, and accordingly the transformation that is fed as an input to the system, and which might result in some kind of a transformation. A system will be effective, that is able to achieve its objective, when there is a match between the information processing requirements facing its parts and their information processing capacity. Okay, so there is a match between information that is you are getting and the capacity to process that particular information. When this state is achieved with a maximum efficiency, we say system is optimized. Okay, so whenever this feedback system and the control mechanism, whenever it is working with a maximum efficiency, we call it as a optimal system. Means optimal is the with a like a peak value, peak productivity, we call such system as a optimal system. Every system has a permeable boundary. Okay, so the one of the things the system approach identified is every system has a some kind of a permeable boundary, not very clear like a physical boundaries, so we cannot see very clear boundaries, but there is a some kind of a boundary. Boundaries can be more clearly observed and therefore more precisely defined where they are physical. For example, we can define the physical boundaries of India very precisely. So whenever we have the physical boundaries, it is very clearly we can identify with the longitude and latitude, we can definitely identify perfectly the boundaries. But this cannot happen in the areas under which the organization we work. They can also be maintained physiologically through symbols. Okay, so one way is like a physical, second one is physiological. How we do that? Such as titles. Okay, when you have the titles for title in the organization, your uniforms, right? So suppose if you see people in military dress or a police uniform, so there is a certain kind of a boundary they create. It is a more of a physiological. And in the organization, the again like a white collar jobs, okay, that gives certain boundary. Then blue collar jobs that gives a certain other boundaries. So uniform and indoctrination rituals. But it is difficult to define a boundary of an organization. Organization being social system do not have clearly observable boundaries. There is kind of a some kind of a boundaries. It may not be very clear boundaries. Generally, the activities necessary for their transformation process define their boundary. So why it is boundaries are important? Whenever we have the transformation processes that are going, that transformation processes, there has to be certain boundaries under which this transformation process will work. The concept of boundary is useful in several ways, such as, okay, discussed below. It helps the system determining where it ends and where the other system begins. Okay, one example is like it will help the particular system in understanding where it starts and where it ends, okay, so that the next system will begin from that point. It divides those elements that are part of the system from those that are part of its environment. So it will provide a division between those the parts which are belong to the system and those parts they belong to the environment, because environment will come in as a input here. Okay, and when we know the boundaries, then only we can take it as a input. When we know the boundary, then only we can give it as a output. It enables a system to protect its transformation process from vagaries of its environment. Vagaries is in the sense any unexpected changes. So when we understand our boundaries, then only we can take care of the lot of unexpected changes in the environment. And we'll see some example for that. Manufacturing organization protect their core operations from fluctuations in market condition by creating several units on the input and output sides of their boundaries. So any manufacturing organization, whatever are their inputs and whatever their outputs, it will create several units so that if there is any market fluctuation, okay, they would be able to sustain. These units are known as boundary spanning units. Okay, so examples of such units on the input side are the purchase and the personnel department. Okay, so on the input side, we have like a purchase department and the personnel. Purchase department is the one which procures the material. Personnel department is the one which recruits the human resources. So, but purchase department ensure a steady flow of standardized input into a production process. So purchase will make sure that whatever the raw material is required is in abundant, and so that it will not have any issue on the production side. Wherever the manufacturing is happening, it is not impacted. For example, Hindalco, when you are going on that highway, you will see a big heap, right? That is nothing but a raw material. So the procurement department will make sure that enough raw material is there. Let us say if there is any kind of a strike or some kind of a problem where they cannot get the raw material, they will have enough stock. Maybe like it will run the factory for, let's say, 6 months or 1 year. Okay, so it will absorb the environment. Okay, absorb the environment in the sense, suppose strike or there is some problem with the supplier or anything, that is absorbed by the purchase department. How they absorb that? By having lot of stock. So when we have a lot of stock, let us say they are good for 1 year. So even there is any problem for 1 year, the factory will not stop. The factory will be continuously running. They protect the process against the several unforeseen events such as strike in suppliers plant. Similarly, personnel departments, constant hiring and training program for certain types of workers absorbs fluctuations in the manpower. We know that people will they leave the organization, that is bound to happen. So personnel department will make sure that the recruitment processes is on and the training is on, so that there is no impact on the organization if anybody leaves. Examples of boundary spanning units on the output side are marketing, warehousing, and quality control. So, input side, we talked about the example is a purchase and the personnel departments. On the output side, it is a marketing, okay, marketing, warehousing, and quality control departments. So, how they can help? Marketing department uncovers trends in the demand, for its organization's products, and communicates this information to purchasing personnel. So marketing, when they are doing the marketing, they will understand the demand, okay, and according to that they will give the input to the purchasing people or the production people. Warehousing permits the technical core to produce at a constant rate, but distribution to fluctuate with the market condition. So warehousing, it can make sure that the distribution, even though there is a fluctuation in the market condition, it is able to distribute with that fluctuation in consideration. Quality department, so it can make sure that the good quality metrics are implemented so that the products are tested very well, so that they can avoid the complaints that organization will get. Quality control department filters out the output of the organization to prevent customer complaints from arising and penetrating organization's boundaries. So how quality can help is like avoiding any future problems in terms of the customer complaints by having a good quality checks on the output that is produced in the organization. Contribution of system approach. In the traditional approaches, only that part of the organization is studied which plagued with the problem, but in the system approach, a problem is studied both at the level of subsystem, micro level, as well as a macro level, that is the total system. That is unlike the traditional approach, where only a plagued system means wherever there is a problem, instead of looking at only that part, it will take a look at the whole organization at micro as well as macro level. The systems approach follow a logical process of deductive inductive reasoning. The questions considered include the following. Okay, how many distinguishable elements are there in this seeming problem? So we have to identify how many different elements are there which we can easily distinguish. Also, we have to see the cause and effect relationship among. When we identify these elements, we have to identify cause and effect between relationship between these element. Function needs to be performed in each case. What kind of functions needs to be performed? So once we identify the relation, what kind of function needs to be performed, and what are the trade-off? Trade-off is like everything. We cannot always create a win-win situation. We need to have some kind of a trade-off. Means we take a hit on certain thing and we work out the solutions. So we have to think about what are the trade-offs we are going to have. Once they are defined, so once all these questions are answered, the reasoning process always goes through several stages of development, starting with a general objective and proceeding to plans. So once we have the general definition, this goes through the several stages of analysis and proceeding with the preparing the plans, then back to redefining the objectives and making more detailed plans, then back again and so forth. So this goes in iteration. Once we have objectives, then we analyze that, make plans, again redefine objectives, and retune the plans. So it will go in a iteration. However, application of this approach to business organizations results in the requirements that executives, in addition to having the skills in their own functional area, should have enough knowledge of other areas also. So in this scenario, when we are analyzing, we should have the knowledge of our own domain as well as the knowledge of the other areas also. They should be generalists. Okay, they cannot be specialist. They should be generalist. Means generally they are aware of all the areas of the organization. There are some writers who contend that there is nothing new in this approach. Okay, so some researchers, they think there are no new ideas, just it is a combination of all the ideas proposed earlier. They say that this approach simply combines the views of the classicists and neoclassicists, which tantamount to pouring old wine into new bottles. So they, some of the researchers, they consider system approach. There is nothing much new about this approach. It is like whatever the classical and neoclassical theories, it is just a combination or a general flavor of that all the approaches. The next one is the contingency approaches. Okay, the contingency approach is the second approach, first being the system approach that attempts to integrate the various schools of management thought. So system approach is the first approach which tried to integrate all the system, and contingency is the second one which thought of integrating the different schools of management thought. According to this approach, management principles and concepts of various schools have no general and universal applicability under all conditions. So according to this, that is very true. Like there is a no general or a universal application of anything under all conditions. So the application of these management principles, it depends on the conditions. So there is no one rule which can be applicable. That is what this contingency approach talks about. In other words, there is no one best way of doing things under all conditions. Methods and techniques which are highly effective in one situation may not work in another situation. Okay. What is good for the goose may not be good for the gander. So they are talking about the two birds. What is good for one bird may not be good for the other. Result differ because situations differ. Okay. Always because situations differ, the results will differ. And according to the conditions, whatever the approach, management approach you want to have, that also differs. The contingency approach suggests that the task of manager is to try to identify which technique will, in a particular situation, best contribute to the attainment of management goals. So we have to think like, with respect to the condition, given condition, manager has to think about the techniques which will be more effective in meeting that particular goal. Managers therefore have to develop some sort of situational sensitivity and practical selectivity. Contingency views are applicable in where it can be applied is in organizational structure, okay, designing organization structure, in deciding the degree of centralization, okay, we can use this approach. In planning information decision systems, in motivational and leadership approaches, in establishing communication and control system, in resolving conflicts and managing change, in employee development and training programs, and in several other areas of organizational organization and management. Pretty much like every aspects of the management, we can use the contingency approach. Okay, the detailed description of these views given at relevant places in the later chapter. So as we go on, we will see their relevancies all along. We have described all major approaches to management thought in terms of their chronological emergence. Okay, so whatever so far we have seen, it is how the different approaches came in a chronological order. It often seems that boundaries between these approaches are becoming progressively less distinct as classical approach, which is incorporating many insights and concepts of the other approaches, continue to remain the most important approach. This is what, like, we seem to see less boundaries between them, and progressively, like, they overlap, and there is a overlap of the thoughts, okay, in these different kinds of approaches. We now find several smart bureaucratic organizations making effort to reduce the amount of work people have to do by getting rid of red tape or helping people understand that they are going to have satisfying career even without ascending hierarchically. So now a lot of new bureaucratic organization, they are making efforts in reducing the amount of work people have to do by removing some kind of a strict rules, okay, some kind of a rigid rules that are in place, and that is how enhancing their satisfaction. Okay, there is a satisfaction of their job by not only giving a hierarchical ascending, but in other terms also. Okay, to summarize what we have learned so far, the history of management can be divided into three, that is, we saw early, neoclassical and modern. In early period, there were three approaches. We saw scientific, administrative and bureaucracy. In neoclassical period, it consists of human relations and behavioral approach. Modern period consists of the quantitative system, quantitative systems and contingency approaches. And each one of the above approaches has made a distinct contribution to management theory. The stress in the scientific management approach is on the task. So in case of a scientific management, there was more stress on the task aspect of a group effort. In administrative management approach, laying down the universal principles of management, and in bureaucracy, it is following the standards of standard rules. So rules were more important in the bureaucracy. In human relations approach, the stress is on the human aspect of group effort. In behavioral approach, it recognizes the practical and situational constraints of human behavior. In case of a quantitative approach, it emphasizes on numerical things like operations research or mathematical decision making. And in case of a system approach, it is a concept of a holism, looking the problem as a whole. In case of a contingency approach, it is to integrate all previous approaches. Contingency is like to integrate all the previous approaches. So that completes the the half portion of the your first module. The later part we have like planning, organizing, and staffing. In the next class, we'll start with the a planning. Okay, planning. Then why? What is planning? What is the nature of planning? Why it is important? Different steps involved in that. So with that thought, we will end today's class.